ಪ್ರಿಯವಾಕ್ಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನೇನ ಸರ್ವೇ ದುಷ್ಯಂತಿ ಜಾತವ.
So lunch, you're going to be having an interact session, and we've got you into groups. When you registered, you'll have got three numbers for each of the 3 days. So look at the first number, and that tells you the group that you're going to be in. When we call you back, the first 8 groups are in the rooms on my left side. 9, 10 and 11 are behind the stage. 12 to 19 is in the hall. Please come into the different areas according to your group number. The second and third numbers are your groups for the second and third days. You will have facilitators in your groups, and what we are looking for from this morning session, what's that wow moment?
Priyavakya pradhanena sarve dushyanti jatava. ಪ್ರಿಯವಾಕ್ಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನೇನ ಸರ್ವೇ ತುಷ್ಯಂತಿ ಜಾತವ. ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ತದೇವ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ತಸ್ಮೇವ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ವಚನೇಕ ದರಿದ್ರತಾ ಪ್ರಿಯವಾಕ್ಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನೇನ ಸರ್ವೇ ದುಷ್ಯಂತಿ ಜಾತವ. ಪ್ರಿಯವಾಕ್ಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನೇನ ಸರ್ವೇ ದುಷ್ಯಂತಿ. ತಸ್ಮಾತ್ ತದೇವ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ತದಾ ತಸ್ಮೇವ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯಂ ವಚನೇಕ ದರಿದ್ರತಾ. ಪ್ರಿಯವಾಕ್ಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನೇನ
ಸಾಯಿರಾ. young, we are strong, we are ready. We are the youth of this world. God gave this world and is guilty. But what have we done to this world? Mother Earth is crying, please help me.
a month or so before Brother Jaga came, he sent me an email and he said, "Are you ready for the storm to hit you?" You know, the day he landed, we had a big storm throughout the country.
And the lights went up.
Yeah, there was no power here, and we were thinking, you know, what's going to happen on the day. No, there was a really storm, because I went to see him the next day, and the whole street, the dust being blown, and paper, and bottles, and he spoke about the Nobel Peace Prize winner. Do you know that he was nominated as a Nobel Peace as a prize by four countries?
The guy who won the prize was Al Gore, the deputy president of USA. No? He won the prize, Nobel Prize, for his work in environment. So four countries nominated me, from Japan, USA, Malaysia, and Zambia. Four countries, Japan, Malaysia, USA, Zambia. They kept it very secret, according to the guys kept it secret until they had no choice but to approach him, because whoever is nominated must agree. If you get the prize, you will accept it, okay? And they don't want somebody to reject the prize, okay? So they said, "What are you guys crazy at representing Nobel Prize? We're not asking you your opinion, he's asking me to sign the name, sign it, and agree." So that's all. Thank you, brother.
What do the judges know? It's a real privilege and a wonderful session, and you'll be seeing fellows running after yandas everywhere now, you know, manifesting rain and snow. Brothers and sisters, before we quickly go for lunch, which will be a 35-minute break, we're coming back to this hall for another breakout session. The whole idea here is what Brother Jaga is doing is raising our level of consciousness and awareness and inspiring us. But inspiration alone doesn't allow transformation. And that's what you're doing, is to see, what did I really get from this session? What are the insights? What are the aha moments? What am I going to do with this? What are we going to do with this? And these are valuable discussions. I just want to quickly touch, you had a session, breakout session yesterday, and you came up with several action points, some of them personal, some of them at a family level, some of them at a community level or center level. Brother Kevin has condensed all that and come up with a few points, and I just thought it's worth just quickly sharing that with you. There's about four or five points, and then we are asking you today to come back, have your lunch quickly, come back into your groups and discuss. There's been four sessions since then. There's been the drops of the ocean, Sharanam, Dharma, Dharma, you know, how to manifest this Sai miracle in our life. We've also had this wonderful formula for being manifesting the pH factor. There's a lot of HP factor here, you know, higher purchase and Harry Potter and all that. But this is the pH factor. Okay, so quickly, the first key point that was picked up was honor our parents. And so this is going to be one of Jaga's key action points, in that he's going to bring it again at the end of the program, and said that this is the foundation on which the community, society, is going to revive its values, etc. Okay? So these are just headings. It's up to you now to see how you're going to implement these programs. The second program, and part of that is that part of that becoming exemplars? Or remember, all of you have now said, before we can propagate to the community, we need to be good examples. Swami's always said, the best service, the highest service you can do is to be a good example. And you have acknowledged that here. So practice, do not preach. Self-assessment and transformations. So a part of that process is to do our own assessment of where we are and where we should go and how we can get there. And very often, you know, we are looking at other people and trying to see, and Brother Jaga has quite clearly said that, just work on us and practice this equanimity. A very important action point for the organization is to create an opportunity. How are we going to learn about our own faith and other faiths? Because we have this Sarva Dharma symbol. I go to recently I've been to a couple of national conferences. One was conducted by the Peace Foundation, it was called the Peace Conference, and about 3 weeks ago, the National Interfaith Council at a national forum, where people from all backgrounds come, and they see my name and the organization, and they say, who's Sathya Sai? Who are you? What do you stand for? And I always say, multi-faith spiritual organization dedicated for the practice and promotion of universal human values and selfless service. And they say, multi-faith spiritual organization? And yet, as Jaga said yesterday, what do we know about the other faith? What do we know about our own faith? Yeah. So this is a collective responsibility, and asking the centers and the regions to look how we can develop programs to encourage them. It has to be a proper study of it. It cannot be done on a ad hoc basis. There's be a structure. So, Namasmarana, you brought this aspect of the power of calling God's name and having the faith and the confidence. Yesterday, Brother Jagaj showed the difference. You may have the faith to call His name, but do we have the confidence that He will respond? And we also touched on CIA. That's another session that's coming later this afternoon, to see how it's not just awareness, it's integrated awareness. We talked earlier this morning about, divinity is pervasive. It's integrated. And for us to have the constant awareness of that, because we forget. So how do we apply that constant integrated awareness? And then you spoke about speaking the truth, but not only just speaking it, the truth, but how do we speak it lovingly, but more importantly, how do we avoid speaking unpleasant truth? Okay? So these are...
Oh.
Session this afternoon, and many of you took part. You had an opportunity to share your insights over the last four sessions. And from that, again, Brother Kevin has picked out about five or six key points that you would like to implement in your lives. So let me just go through them very quickly with you. So the first one is where the brother said about self-effort is the first step. There's no need to seek divine grace, which is always omnipresent. But through self-effort, can we play a role in His divine will? Can we be an instrument to implement His will? Remember the two hands of the scissor. Can we become one arm of that system? The second...
Self-effort is the divine will operating through you. Because God is inside you. Self-effort is the divine will operating through you. Because tattvamasi, aham brahmasmi. So, don't misunderstand. Doesn't mean you're going to pray. But the prayer is, how can I improve my self-effort? Ultimately, you achieve that. Okay?
The second one was relating to faith. And you talked about confidence and having unconditional faith. Actually, you cannot say faith is 50%, 60%, 70%. It's got to be 100%. So the question is, do we have unconditional faith? If you have faith, it has to be unconditional. The same as love. You cannot say, I have love and then I have attachment. How do I love without attachment? The moment we have attachment, it cannot be love. There's only one love, that's love without attachment. The same goes with the next one, which you have chosen, which is surrender. Same thing. Either you surrender or you're not. Okay? There's no kind of partial surrender. It has to be total surrender, and that's what you come up with. See, these are all little mini points, but you have to develop an action plan as to, like the plug-in, this, the 15 steps. Now what we're going to practice is total surrender. Atma Nivedana, brother spoke yesterday. Ultimate, total surrender. And it also, you looked at the aspect of breaking the coconut and the significance of that. Most people break coconuts as a sign of ego. But the purpose is to eliminate the ego. Equanimity. So brother talked about the 1947 historical letter that Bhagavan wrote to his brother, where he gave, when he wrote that, he said, I have my own definition of a devotee. The one who meets success, failure, victory, defeat, praise, blame, all these with perfect equanimity. That is, we refer to ourselves as Sai devotees, but you know, Baba never refers to us as devotees. Priya versus Shreya, I think this was discussed actually yesterday. So one is saying that if what seems bitter in the beginning gives us nectar at the end, and the other one which seems like nectar at the beginning becomes poisonous in the air. I remember Brother Jega at the very first World Youth Conference. There were three or four official programs, and then there was an unofficial program, so we called everybody in for a special discourse. I think it was 19th of July 1997 in the Purnachandra Hall. And there, Swami talked about a conversation that took place between Saint Vyasa and the Dava and Kusa. And Swami said, imagine you have two pots. One pot contains poison, one pot contains nectar, and one pot, let me rephrase this. There are two pots. One is a golden pot, one is a mud pot. Which one would you choose? Mostly people will prefer the golden pot. But he said, now the golden pot contains poison, but the mud pot contains nectar. Which one would you choose? Mud pot. Or you throw the poison and she'll go for the gold. What Swami said was, the mud pot that contains poison is this world that glitters and manipulates us. The golden pot, sorry. And you're still awake, brother, even after all your talk. The mud pot that contains nectar is this body made up of the five elements, but contains the divine spark. So this part here tells us that to choose the right pot, to identify with the right pot. And then finally, you come up with watching our thoughts, words and deeds, because now we understand who punishes whom. If we have our thoughts and words and deeds as a consequence of that, we either curse or bring blessings to our own self. Okay, so that's a summary of the sessions from today.
I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. Swami says that surrender to the Lord is possible if you think about the Lord without a moment's break. He says that we can actually tie up the Lord with our devotion, our bhakti, keep him a prisoner in our heart. I surrender to the love of Swami flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Swami flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Swami flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Swami flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Swami flowing through my life. Swami says that in his previous incarnations, he is the very same Rama and Krishna, now alive as Bhagawan Sri Sathya Sai Baba. I surrender to the love of Krishna flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Krishna flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Krishna flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Krishna flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Krishna flowing through my life. Swami has said that Rama came to bring back truth and righteousness to the planet. That was the purpose of his incarnation. And that Krishna came to bring peace and love back. But now all four are in danger of being dried up, and that's why the present avatar of Bhagawan Sri Sathya Sai has come to revive all four of these: truth, righteousness, peace, and love. All praise to Lord Sai. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Sai flowing through my life. I surrender to the love of Shirdi flowing through.
Thank you,
my
life. Cheaply by getting up and clapping, okay? New Zealand will become a lighthouse. Interface, you know, to no agenda. Thank you, Pandit. Thank you.
Yendro Kolde Peridokum, Tanmahane, Sandro Yella Ketatai. No, a great poet 3,000 years ago said, the happiness that mother gets during childbirth is far exceeded when the child is honored
by people as a virtuous son. What he has done, what he stands in front today, is an exemplification of that quotation.
My mother would be proud.
Mother would be really proud. Please give him a big hand. New Zealand, not just a lighthouse, must now become New Silent.
Hey, big hand for that. Hold on. Only those who believe you want to work with him to make it happen clap. Others don't clap, please. Yeah. I thought only 2% clap.
It was interesting. It was during the very first World Youth Conference in 97. Some of you were here. Michael is here. That Swami actually come up to us in the main section and asked, where are you from? And when he said New Zealand, he said, no, New Zealand. And Michael at least said it on two occasions, right? So Swami has seen the potential that we haven't seen. And Brother Jaga has shown that it's possible. So you have sat through these past 3 days, you have been inspired. And as I said, it's a four-step process. The first step is to come here. When you come here, our awareness is raised. You feel it? Awareness, our consciousness is raised. And right now, we all feel inspired, correct? That's as far as Brother Jaga can go. He can raise our level of consciousness, awareness, and he's inspired us. But what we have to do now is to go and experience this. We have to do it ourselves to experience it. When we do it, we have to be and do it. And then others will tell it. The sharing. Finally comes the sharing. And that triggers. What brother has done is he has come and shared what he has done. And he started this cycle again. To inspire. And this is how it should happen. So, to summarize what you discussed today, two main points have come, because this morning and this afternoon was pretty much, there was a link, a connection. But the Jaga talked to the two symbols that Swami has given for the organization. One is the Sarvadharma symbol and one is the value symbol. How can we dovetail these two together and bring this unity of faith and the hope and living agenda? So you have raised two important points. Must give a big hand to Brother Kevin, who takes all these 150 ideas and puts them into, like Swami, like Jaga has done, you know, just 2 points. 2 drops of the ocean. And the first one you said you want to do is to connect with all faiths. Connect with all faiths. Of course, yeah? Now, do you know how many faiths there are in New Zealand when you made this statement? You're joking, huh? Alright. Let's start with, I'm giving you a challenge. See if you can start with 3 faiths. That is each center. Your first duty is to 2 faiths. That is the Maori people and the Christian community. The Maori, as you all of you know, the indigenous people, and the Christians are the majority. Every corner you go, you see a church. Am I right? Yeah, it's not difficult. And if you can do that, and I heard some discussions how that may be possible. I shared this with a couple of groups as I was going around. One of the successful method it worked was in the Hatpeli Center some years ago. When Kolita, you all of you know Kolita, a wonderful ex-choir master, took the group went to the Jewish synagogue and learned how to sing Jewish songs. Came back and trained the entire congregation how to sing Jewish songs. And then for the Jewish festival, when he invited them to come, they were stunned because this group could sing Jewish songs better than they could. See, it's not a one-off calling and inviting a visitor to you and giving a talk, or you going once and doing a one-off pilgrimage. It has to be a sustained effort if you genuinely want to establish relationship. Because that's the first thing. You have said you want to connect, but you don't want to disconnect very quickly either. You must build on that relationship. It must be a genuine relationship where you extend your hand and you're prepared to work with them. Then they will come and are prepared to work with us in our agendas. The second thing that you've mentioned here is to engage in joint service and celebratory programs. But let's look at the first one, because we are good at celebrating things. But can we do these service programs? And then let's celebrate that part of it. Brother mentioned earlier that it's possible that now when we observe these religious festivals, we can launch service programs to in honor of the founder of these faiths. Yeah? So when we do Christmas, Easter, Buddha Purnima, and so forth, Matarangi Day, you know, can we do service projects to in honor of that? When we do that, it's possible to bring these friendship groups to be part of it, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's possible. So we've got to start thinking like this. And we don't have to create new projects, because we've already discussed. In fact, a lot of these things will overlap. You may think, oh my God, I've got to do hope, I've got to do that, I've got to do this. When you start with one and do it well, it will take its own life. So there's a lot of possibilities with human value dramas. We suddenly identified in this group, there are Dharma directors, there are people who can write, there are people who can script, and you can, when you connect with these interfaith groups, it's amazing the kind of resources you tap into. I'm hoping that when we talk to Jill, you know, we link in with Tina's group as well. Tina? Yeah? So you're sitting there with all your resources, and you've got access to so many resources now. The New Zealand police and the Hibiscus Coast teams, and you know, isn't it? So automatically you find there's suddenly she's working with about 10 agencies. So this networking needs to happen, and you know, we're really hoping that, I think June is the date we're planning to do the first interfaith service program. So we're going to start the planning process right now. And then it's possible to do the hope agenda as well. I don't know if you mentioned earlier that one of the initiatives that's happened behind the scene is a school has invited,
started with
one school who was interested in a diversity program that Ashika's children go to in Upper Harbour Primary. In talking, we mentioned about the Unity of Faith program, and then we got from Brother Jaga his book. And from that, we have developed, they've asked for what is known as a toolkit to train the teachers on diversity. Started with faith, and now they've gone to unity in diversity. They've invited other schools to come. So suddenly, I know that there's a possibility where we could get the schools to do their own human value drama festival. You know, even if it's three schools, we may need some help in those things, where youngsters can come and link and train or whatever it may be. So we need to be now respond to their needs. People asking us for help, can we be creative enough to and give the commitment? I know that we don't want to overburden you guys. A very common complaint that I get is burnout. Young people are getting burnt out, and that's because you know, the workload is not being shared. You know, if I call the house budget, at least 100 people will come. When I call for an interfaith meeting in October, 15 people came. Why is that? So now we have to really be committed. This is why Jaga has come to really, you know, inspire us and to do how to. We don't need grace. It's how to invoke that divine will. Okay. So really, if you're serious about this, you must go back and start establishing real relationship with. Start with the Maori people. Start with the Christian group. Start, you know, working with them. Okay. That's fine. Quakers is a Christian group, right? Quakers are Christians, Methodists, Anglicans, Seventh-day Adventists, you know, you name it, this whole raft of... In the event, you can't, but I would suggest, you see, I did some statistics for brother asked me, sometimes, you know what population of Hindus are in this country? 1.5%. But we make 99% of the SAI organization. Last night I was doing a research because I got invited to attend to there's a in Parliament on the 30th of March the launch of the diversity of religious group in New Zealand. Helen Clark is coming to launch it. Unfortunately, the invitation came so late, and Brother Jagadeesan on another program. But Brother Kumar will be representing us. There's such interest now, but in the statistics, when we look at it. They are in that program, so I went to research more about them, how did this happen. And there's a professor in Wellington University who's done all the groundwork and the paperwork. And he's got all the history of the religions in New Zealand. There's about 10 main faiths. Where do you think the Sathya Sai organization sits? Under which faith? So there's Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, blah blah, and multi-faith. Where does Sathya Sai organization sit? We are classified as a Hindu group. I'm very sad to say that, but that is the perception, and it is not a false perception. And the only group that doesn't belong into one of these categories is Baha'i faith. It would be a terrible disservice for Swami if he were to remain and identify as that. So that to me is the biggest challenge. When I was asked to take on this role, and I only got 24 hours to say yes or no. When brother said, "But Ravi, would you consider this role?" I said, "I'm just happy to do Swami's work." No. He said, "No or no." And there was a telephone conversation with Dr. Pal Dad, who was zone chair. And I never met him. There was a telephone conversation. And he asked me, "So what's your biggest challenge in New Zealand?" I said, our biggest challenge is this, that we are being perceived as an Indian or a Hindu organization. That has been the biggest obstacle. That's not, you know, not entirely the fault of each one of us, but we must take some responsibility. And so I think there's enough here to show that if in Malaysia, what did he say, 7% Indians, 10%? 7%. The New Zealand, the Sathya Sai Council in Malaysia, is known for human values. Human values, Sathya Sai organization is known. Now they are known for all these community programs. They've broken down a lot of barriers. And Tina has spoken some lovely words about what we are capable of doing and supporting. So we just have to do better. And take collective responsibility for that. And we need the support of the youth. But youth, I want to tell you that we, the council, the trust, want to do everything possible to encourage you and to give you the opportunity. We will support you in any way we can. You have our backing. That's why we bought Suresh 2 years ago, because these are the kind of people who have demonstrated by action. So you need to, you know, tell us what we can do to remove any barriers that come in the way. If people are asking you to do too many things, you need to step back and say no, you know, and we need to preserve you. Okay, you're too precious. Our biggest exports is young people, you know. Every time we develop these young stars, we seem to be, "Hey, Sabina, Veena, you keep grabbing them." So, anyway, that's another story. Okay, thank you. Kevin, where are you? I think you and Ravi Grover, brother, there was an action plan that you want to launch based on some of the drops of the ocean that Jaga had given. So you wanted to come and share that quickly?
Om Sai Ram. How many of you have been inspired by the weekend's events, Brother Jaga's sessions, his personal stories, the things that I've done in Malaysia, Sister Tina's presentation? Now, please, you'll have a feel-good factor, you'll have that inspiration, you'll have that enthusiasm, you'll have shown that with some of the ideas you have brought out during the breakout sessions. When you leave, do not leave that enthusiasm and that inspiration at the exit. Take it back to your families, your centers, and the community. And to help you, we thought that all the ideas that you brought out during those breakout sessions, we're going to try and get the quotes and Swami's teachings related to that, so that you can take these and expand on them at your study circles. Now, at your study circle, some of you are just starting and need some encouragement. We have Brother Ravi Grover here, that's study circle coordinator, but he's also willing to be the other side of a phone for some long distance conversations as well. So he's also willing to help you.
Yes, I am. Firstly, thank you very much for organizing such a beautiful event. I was very touched when I saw 140 devotees doing study circle for the first time yesterday. That was amazing. 140 devotees here, all dedicatedly, lovingly doing the brainstorming. I walked around, saw what the point they are writing, and I'm sure we all will be more happier if we continue that for time to come. Not only for this weekend, for every week. What we plan to do is now, very generously you people have all put down your points on the paper. We try to collect the information, write up something about that, get back to you, so that you can continue doing study circles on those subjects. And if you need any help, I'm just a phone call away. Brother Kevin is there to help you as well. Brother Ravi is there. And I'm very happy to see every group has two facilitators. Therefore, there are people who can facilitate study circles. There are people who know how to run study circles. All you really want the motivation and inspiration provided by Brother Jaga. So please keep it up with this, and we will carry on the flame burning in our heart till we reach salvation. Thank you.
I have a final duty, which is to thank so many people who put this event together. You know, it's one of the most unbelievable things. This has been done completely free, this whole event for the 3 days. And it's, but also that everything happened so smoothly, right? Any complaints? Remember what Dr. Jega said? Any complaints? Are you happy? Everything went smooth. I really thank you. A special thanks to all the people who first came. You know, we only got the hall at 7 o'clock in the morning, and within 2 hours, 2.5, everything was set up here. So thanks for all the people who came, and there's just decorations, the systems, the food people. Amazing job. Really, sir. Fantastic. Sister Sada, the ladies team, you are amazing. Just, all the volunteers of the car park, Sevadas, sound technicians, sound people. I may miss some of you. Young people, thank you so much. You stood here and sat here for 3 days. Great pleasure. Some of you have come from long way, from out of town. I really appreciate your commitment. Sister Veena from Australia, thank you for being here. Now I know there's a tomorrow youth leadership program and a teen youth program. A slight alteration to the program. What Brother Jaga said is, because the blessing ceremony is really an interaction between parents and children. See how important. So what he would like to do is to do the blessing tomorrow and would like as many parents to come. So if you can, I know it's a bit late, but if you can tell the parents to come, even if they can't be there at the beginning, if they could come at the end to do the blessing ceremony. Okay? Time, ask them to come at 4 o'clock. Yeah? Oh, most of them will be there? Okay, good. But if there's anybody else that's coming, because that's the significance of the blessing is to for the parents and the children to be there. Okay? Okay, so I'm just thinking how should we finish? You know, when we do service, who's the greatest recipient when we go out and do all this work? It's us. In 2008, I don't know, Brother Inder, are you here? Yes, we got involved with there's a refugee center in Auckland. New Zealand is one of the few countries out of 8 countries that has signed up a charter with the United Nations to bring in refugees officially into this country. So 750 refugees are brought in to New Zealand. And I've been involved from 1999. After the Second World Youth Conference, they passed a resolution that we must undertake service projects minimum 3 years. So I've been involved with these Burmese refugees since then. So one day, some of these refugee children were at home, and I'd invited them. I must have been by birthday. They came home to watch a Hindi movie, the cricket match. No. Lagan. Yeah, they love watching Lagan, you know. And then one of the Burmese father, I asked him to stay. He said, no, my wife, we're taking some food to the Nagari camp, the refugee camp. And I said, what's the occasion? He said, oh, there's a new group come. But he said, look, brother, there's one family, you know, they're very, the man is disabled, he can't move, and, you know, some help is needed there. So Brother Inder and I went to see them. And I saw there were some people for the first time in the refugee camp, people like me, you know, like Indian people. Because normally you don't get... So I went and looked on the board and I saw Bhutan. I never heard of Bhutan, you know. Bhutan is... So I went to... And then I saw somebody on the phone, ladies dressed in sari and with tamputu. So I said, are you from Bhutan? Suddenly 40 people were around us. And the next thing we knew was starting a beautiful journey with these people. And we would have a program. Every 6 weeks, 8 weeks, they would come. They'd be there for 6 weeks and they'd be resettled in different parts of New Zealand. They were vegetarians, most of them. And it was the hardest thing for them. They couldn't eat the food because there was all of meat. And so we'd take them out, give them vegetarian food. And then depending on their faith, they'd go to temples, they'd go to mosques, they'd go to church. And a lovely relationship started. And we would organize welcome programs and a farewell program. And in the last one of the farewell, third group said, Uncle, you know, you always entertain us, sing to us and all that, but can we sing a song for you? We said, of course. And they sang this song. I'll just tell you the meaning so that you'll appreciate and how important this is. This has made a big, significant impact in my life. And the song is composed by a Tibetan nun, a Buddhist nun who lives in Nepal. Because they ended up in Nepali camps, the Bhutanese, 150,000 of them. And the song says, in the eyes of a flower, the whole world is a flower. In the eyes of a thorn, the whole world is a thorn. The shadows reflect the objects. And then he's saying, let my heart and mind be pure like Lord Buddha. So that even when I walk, let me not trample even an insect by accident. If you have a pure mind, if you have a clean mind, the whole world will be clean.
And in the next verse it says, let me choose my life partner in a prosperous way. And even in darkness, let me see light. If my mind is happy, the whole world is happy. Give me F.
Purko akama pura samsara kaadako akama kaada samsara.
Occasion. May you all be happy. May you all love thy neighbor as thyself. God bless Sathya.
Samaste Lokaya.
sarve dushyanti jatava. Priyavakya pradanena sarve dushyanti jatava. Tasmat tadeva kartavyam. Tada tasmeva kartavyam. Janika Daridratam.